We've all heard the headlines about Kiwis headed overseas for a better life, usually across the ditch. But what about the people who move to New Zealand? They help fill jobs like teaching and nursing while at the same time contributing to our economy. At least that's what we thought. The Reserve Bank now says much of our immigration is temporary. Overseas workers here for a short time and sending their paychecks back home. Is that good for our country and our economy? For his perspective, we spoke with economist and editor of the Kaka, Bernard Hickey, and I asked him, if these migrants are staying but not spending, are we really getting a good deal?
Well, we're certainly getting the work, and it's certainly helping to stop lots of wage inflation. So if you're a business, you're happy that your wage inflation isn't taking off. But there are other effects, particularly around rents. Those people have to live here and pay for a rent or bunk down with someone else. So there's extra pressure on the rental part of the market. Now, if they're not here permanently, it's unlikely they're going to buy a home. So that may not increase house prices. So there's swings and roundabouts on the inflation side of things.
So presumably this sort of migration is putting pressure on some of the same services residents or citizens use, like signing up to the doctor or enrolling their kids in school.
That's right. Although it is complicated if you're only on a temporary work visa because you don't have the same access to hospital services, and it's going to be more difficult if you want to get kids into school. And of course, for a lot of those people who have come here, they've only come here by themselves. They haven't come with their families. So, and then there's an interesting period where the assumption is they're going to go home before the 3 years is up. Not everyone does. Many apply for permanent residency. And then once they have that, then they can add to demand for housing, and then they can look to go to hospitals and start to have families and lives. And that starts to put extra pressure on our infrastructure.
I want to talk about them staying on in a minute, but can we talk about what you just mentioned? Have you got any idea how much money they're sending overseas that they're earning here but they're not spending here?
That's a great question, which the Reserve Bank is going to do more research on, along with other parts of the migration puzzle, because we really don't know exactly how it affects inflation and demand for goods and services, because it sort of depends on what the situation is when those migrants arrive, what type of migrants they are. Are they here for the long term or the short term? Are they here on their own or if they come with families? And these are the things which means that sometimes you can have a migration surge which is inflationary, and then sometimes you can have an inflation surge which is deflationary. And this one, the Reserve Bank's not quite sure of yet.
How come? How come we haven't been measuring this?
Well, there have been attempts to do it. And the assumption in the past was that a migration surge would add to inflation. But then we had a migration surge and inflation was quite low, particularly from 2017 to 2020. And that was clear then that a lot of that migration was temporary migration and it was putting downward pressure on wages. So the problem is it's a moving feast, not just the migration, but the economy itself. So you could have a migration surge hit an economy and it turn inflationary if the economy is stretched to the limit. Whereas if the migration surge hits when the economy is in the doldrums, it may not have an inflationary effect. So it is difficult for the Reserve Bank to work out. It's worth highlighting that sometimes a migration surge can actually depress wages, particularly if you get a lot of people in here on relatively low-skilled jobs.
So is this good migration for us at the moment, and is it making our economy more productive and more highly skilled?
Migration is a many-edged sword in which it's fantastic if you're a small business and you don't want to invest a lot of money in new capital to be able to use machines to do your work, and it's actually cheaper just to employ more people to add to your production. It's also fantastic if you've managed to wangle a way to pay these people below minimum wage or to get them to work for 50 hours instead of the 20 hours that you're actually paying them for. Now, the bigger issue, though, is that we've become addicted to low-skilled migration because it is the best way to grow your business without having to invest. And that leaves you spare cash to invest in other much more profitable ways to invest. And in New Zealand, that means anything that involves some land, a mortgage, and then just waiting for house prices and land prices to rise. It's much, much better.
We do see overseas, you know, cases like the United States, where there becomes this idea, this resentment of migration or of migrants. You know, they're taking all our jobs, they're coming here and taking opportunities that I want. Do you think we would see that with this sort of migration in New Zealand?
That becomes more of an issue when you have high unemployment, but for a long time we haven't had that. The different issue in New Zealand is not so much they're coming here and taking our jobs, it's they're coming here and taking our rental property. And they're pushing up rents, and if they stay here, then they're pushing up house prices. It actually highlights an enormous double standard, where New Zealanders have this feeling that we are welcoming, that we are open, and that we are very cosmopolitan in the way we view the world, when actually we have become the Dubai of the South Pacific, where we enable substantial migrant exploitation. And in fact, large chunks of our economy depend on migrant exploitation, being able to pay well below minimum wages, to have people working way longer than they say they are, and a lack of checks by our under-resourced health and safety and work standards bureaucrats means that a lot of these cases are missed. This is the dirty little secret of our economy, that we have come to rely on exploiting a group of people to keep our business model going. And that business model is don't invest in your business, put all your money into residential land, and that's where the real money is.